Welcome, everybody, to Phoenixville Library. I'm Mark Pinto, the Adult Services Director. And we're pleased to have back tonight for the fourth time, and I think that's something of a record here, for a guest, James Mullaney, astronomer, celestial evangelist. Is there any intelligent life out here tonight? Well, that's the question that he will answer, help answer for us tonight. James Mullaney is an astronomy writer and lecturer who has authored 10 books and published nearly 1,000 articles on observing the wonders of the heavens and logged over 20,000 hours of stargazing time with the unaided eye, binoculars, and telescopes. He's a former curator of the Buell Planetarium and Institute of Popular Science in Pittsburgh and director of the DuPont Planetarium at USCA. He served as staff astronomer at the University of Pittsburgh's Allegheny Observatory and as an editor for Sky and Telescope magazine. And in recognition of his work, he's been elected a fellow of the prestigious Royal Astronomical Society of London. We are very pleased to have him back with us tonight, James Mullaney.
Thank you, for the warm welcome, and thank you, Mark. It is great to be back here for the fourth time. That's always great when they get invited back. Before we go any further, I've got to make a disclaimer. I really appreciate the nice introduction, but folks, I want you to know something. I'm just a humble stargazer, and I mean that sincerely. You can't be an astronomer and have a big head as you look out into the vastness of the universe. So I'm just Starman Jim, stargazer, whatever you want to call me, but nothing pompous, okay? Well, we have an exciting three-part program for you tonight. The theme is the biocosmos, life everywhere. And as I think I'll be able to convince you, the universe is alive with life, intelligent life, okay? And we have some exciting announcements to share with you. One of them was made about 6 days ago, one of the discoveries. We'll be sharing a lot of those. The first part of the program, we'll talk about how they find extraterrestrial life, how they find other planets around other solar systems, some of the things that are going on, some of the methods that are being used, and then some of the results, especially the Kepler mission, which is just phenomenal, the discoveries that has made of other solar systems. And I'll say a few words about UFOs. I've been deeply involved with them in the past and worked with J. Allen Hynek and some of the other biggies, Stan Friedman. But I just want to make a passing comment about it. I could easily do a whole program, and have done whole programs on UFOs and the search for extraterrestrial intelligence, okay? The second part of the program are the incredible images from the Hubble Space Telescope, okay? And I update these continuously. Welcome. I update these continuously, okay? And we have some of the old favorites. That I know you would like to see again, but I have some brand new ones. And in fact, the last three images that I'm going to show you, one, two, three, actually we put four in there, I think will blow your mind, okay? So if you fall asleep, that's okay. Just stay awake for the last couple slides. I can bring a bell or something, okay? So that's the second part of the program. Third part of the program is always the iffy one, as Mark well knows. Our intention is to do some stargazing, okay? I'll explain what I mean by that. If it turns out it's cloudy, we will have a Q&A session, and we've had some wonderful Q&A sessions both here and elsewhere where I've lectured, okay? And by the way, our target tonight, I'll have to tell you after I, at the end of the slides, the images, I'm gonna go out and check the sky and the visibility. We've got passing clouds, we've got trees everywhere, but we do have a couple planets out, and I'll try to pick one, hopefully Saturn or Jupiter, that you might be able to observe. Now, please don't let the size of this telescope fool you, okay? This is one of those space age marvels. It's called a Schmidt-Cassegrain catadioptric. Big name for the fact that they've taken two kinds of telescopes, the two basic telescopes, and put them together. It was developed for the space program. That model was up on the space shuttle many times, that particular model. On a good night, if the moon was out, it's not out tonight, a couple of the sessions we did have the moon on. This thing is capable of showing you Phoenixville if you put it on the moon a quarter of a million miles away. You can look in and see it, okay? So it's quite a capable telescope. Well, if I were a betting man, and I'm not, I would bet we're not gonna see a darn thing tonight. How's that for positive thinking? If my dear wife were here, she'd be very upset. But you see, the problem is that clouds follow astronomers around wherever they go. And it can be perfectly clear, and then, you know, by the time the program comes in, it can be totally overcast by the time it gets dark. But, you know, I really wasn't kidding you. I just did a conference in the Blue Ridge Mountains at Little Switzerland, the Wild Acres Retreat, three nights, 500 stargazers from all over the country. Downpours the first night. It didn't clear up until the third night. But anyway, back to this thing that clouds follow astronomers around. I have to tell you this story because it's so unbelievable. The world's largest lens-type telescope is at the Yerkes Observatory, Williams Bay, Wisconsin. The University of Chicago runs it. And although they have the largest telescope of its type in the world, they have the worst observing record of any observatory, at least in North America, probably the world. And you know why? The astronomers there brought this on themselves. Guess what the names of five of the directors of this prestigious observatory were? Doctors, of course, all doctors. Doctors Hale, Gale, Snow, Frost, and Rainey. True story. So we do bring this on ourselves. But I will check the sky after we're done with the Hubble images, okay? All right. Let's set the stage for what we're going to be doing tonight by doing two thought experiments, okay? Einstein was famous for this. He would sit in his study at Princeton, there at his desk and looking at his chalkboard and so on, and yet his mind was all over the universe, out among the galaxies, down inside the atom, the atomic nucleus. And as we know, he changed the world by just thinking, okay, and doing thought experiments. So first of all, to give you a better feeling for how vast this universe is, okay, the first thought experiment is, let's imagine you go to your favorite beach and sit down on the beach, take a big bucket with you, it's going to be really big, sit down on the beach there by the water, pick up one grain of sand and count one, and then two, and then three, and so on. I have here a container, and I think this audience is small enough, you can see it's not even filled to the top. There's a quarter of a million grains of sand in there. Quarter of a million. So obviously on that beach around you, there's a lot of sand. Well, this is not a guess. This has been repeatedly done statistically on Cray 3 supercomputers, and it was just repeated 2 months ago, and I'm going to give you the latest figures. We always said there are more stars, if you were to count every single grain of sand, on all the beaches and deserts on the planet Earth, you wouldn't be anywhere near the number of stars. And then a few years ago, we upped that to about 10 stars through every sand grain. It's just been announced that for every grain of sand, there are 10,000 stars within reach of our largest telescopes. And stars are suns. And we now know they all, if not all, most of them, have planets circling them. So it's amazing, isn't it? Think about that the next time you're anywhere near a pile of sand, even walking on the street, just pick some up and let it trickle through your fingers and think about that. Okay, the other thought experiment I wanted to do, oh, by the way, just looking here, reminded me of something. In case things get boring tonight, and since we're just doing a program on extraterrestrial life, Biocosmos, I want you to know, I was gonna promise this if it got cloudy, but what the heck, this is a small audience, I think we can do it anyway, it wouldn't mind. I am going to introduce you to an extraterrestrial visitor. And I'm not kidding. I have an ET here, okay? And I'm going to share it with you and show it to you, okay? So, again, hang on. All right, the second thought experiment is this. The standard yardstick for astronomers is the light year. You've all heard that term. It's the distance a beam of light travels in 1 year. Light travels fast, 186,000 miles a second. I'm sure you've heard that number. That, you know, it's kind of meaningless, but if light could bend, if you had a flashlight and turned it on and the light could bend, it would circle the Earth 7 times in 1 second. If you point a flashlight at the moon, it would get there in less than 2 seconds. The sun, about 8 minutes. The outermost planets, about 5 hours. And the nearest stars, years, 4 to 5 years to the very nearest of the stars. So it's a big number. It's the number 6 with 12 zeros after it. Excuse me. I'm one of those people really gets attacked by pollen. Boy, it's been a year, hasn't it? Okay. So we're talking 6 trillion miles, 6 with 12 zeros. Meaningless, right? I mean, You can walk a few miles, you can drive a few hundred, you can fly a few thousand, but when you get into millions, billions, and trillions, forget it. So here's the next thought experiment. Let's imagine, I'm probably driving Mark nuts because I tend to pace a lot and actually, I see Mark one.
I'll do it anyway.
Keeps me.
Let's imagine that you're at home in your favorite easy chair, okay? Maybe waiting for dinner. By the way, have you ever noticed the similarities of the words astronomy and gastronomy? How do you think I got this big? By the way, my excuse is, and it doesn't work much anymore, it's an expanding universe, okay? Back to the thought experiment. If you were to sit in your easy chair and start counting the number of miles in a light year at the rate of 1 mile a second, okay, 1, 2, 3, and so on, guess how long it would take you to count up to that number, 6 trillion. It would take you 150,000 years. Years to count the number of miles in one light year. There's no star within the light year except our own sun, and we're now, as you're going to see in the last couple of images, almost 14 billion light years out, and we know there's more out there, other bubble universes. That's a topic if we have a Q&A time, okay? All right, let me share with you, since we're talking about extraterrestrial life, the search for it anyway. I wanted to share a couple quotes with you that I think are very important. Let's see, first of all, Thomas Carlyle said, if there's nobody else out there, what a waste of space, okay? But we're sure the creator of the universe did not waste space. And again, we believe the universe is teeming with life. De Broglie, Nobel Prize winner in physics, he said, either humankind is alone in the universe or we're not. Either alternative is mind-blowing. Interesting, isn't it? We're the only ones. Oh, wow. But we don't think it. We are. All right. When they, about 20 years ago now, the message is still on its way, Carl Sagan, my mentor and late friend, and boy, what an incredible person he was, he conceived this message to send out into space to extraterrestrials and hope somebody would receive it. Not the gold disc on the Voyagers, but a radio message. And they sent it from Arecibo, Puerto Rico. The energy they used, in fact, it's amazing they didn't melt the antenna down, okay? The energy they used in that burst when they sent it out was so intense that if you had eyes sensitive to radio, the Earth would have been brighter than the sun. And it's out there, and it's on its way. And when that happened, Arthur Clarke, who's no longer with us, unfortunately, he wrote this. I can never look now at the Milky Way without wondering from which of those bank clouds of stars the emissaries are coming. If you'll pardon so commonplace a simile, we have set off the fire alarm and have nothing to do but wait. And I don't think we're going to have to wait for long. How about that? We've certainly let the universe know we're out there. And on a spiritual note, I prefer spiritual as opposed to religious note. I'm taking this quote from the Catholic Church because they were so against the idea of other worlds and other life, where things have changed. By the way, Pope John Paul commissioned the giant telescope that's out in Arizona on Mount Graham. He was an amateur astronomer since the age of 11. In fact, he had two of my books at his private observatory at Castel Gandolfo. He loved to stargaze. He commissioned this giant telescope, which most people don't know about, but it's open to the public, okay? It's called the Popescope. Well, lovingly, we call it the Popescope. Anyway, prior to the time he passed, the Vatican Observatory at Castel Gandolfo hosted an international conference. And I forget the attendance, it was huge, but it was all over the place. The front page of USA Today even carried it, all the Catholic newspapers. And guess what the title of the conference was? Astrobiology, the search for life on other worlds. And Pope released this. It's both illogical and arrogant to believe we are the only intelligent beings in God's creation. How about that? So that's amazing. So even the Catholic Church has come around to realizing that we're not alone, okay? God's a big God, God of the entire universe. Now, let me say a few words about particularly the Kepler mission. Well, let me back up a minute. I think I should probably cover the different methods that are used for finding other planets, okay? And the first method has been around for a long time, way back when. It's theoretical. It's the fact that stars, they believe, long believe, that when a star is born, it sheds a layer of material around it, and that material becomes the star's planets. Well, as an example, welcome. Let's take an ice skater, a figure skater. As she is spinning, she's spinning and pulls her arms in closer and closer, closer to her body, what happens? She spins faster and faster. And stars do this as they are condensing, as you're going to see some beautiful images from the Hubble of newborn baby stars. They're spinning at incredible speeds. If something doesn't slow their rotation down, they'll shred themselves. How does the ice skater stop her spin? Throws her arms on. How does the star do it? It sheds these rings of material, and they in turn become the planets and their moons, and they are like the brake shoes, the stellar brake shoes that slow down. Every star that's been looked at in detail for its rotation speed has shown this sudden drop at a particular stage when it's at that stage of evolution. Well, there's three basic methods of finding planets. There's actually four, thanks to new technology, but three basic ones. And I worked for 10 years on one of them at the Allegheny Observatory in Pittsburgh. It has an enormous telescope. Most people, again, don't even know it's there. And it's called the astrometric method. And what it is you take an image of a star, and if you study the star, you'll see that if a star has planets, it will slowly wobble as it goes across the sky, okay? And, for example, if you looked at the sun from one of the nearby stars, the sun wobbles with a period of 12 years. Jupiter, 12 years. If you had better equipment, more refined techniques, you'd see Saturn, 30-year wobble, and then the smaller planets. That's been around for 30, 40, 50 years maybe, and it's found many wobbling stars. And from the amount of the wobble, and if you know the distance of the stars and Kepler's laws, you can actually weigh that object. And they're not other stars. There's a lot of double stars out there, but these are planets, okay? The second method is related to that. It's called the spectroscopic method. And that is that as a planet orbits a star, when it's on one side of the star, it pulls it toward the Earth. On the other side of the star, it pulls it away from the Earth. These are all incredibly small amounts, okay? It takes incredible equipment to detect this. It's called the Doppler shift. And what happens is you can see the lines in the star spectrum doing this as the planet orbits it. And they started finding these by the dozens, okay? The most powerful and successful technique is the photometric technique. And what that is, stars are oriented in all different directions in space, but if you get enough stars, you're going to have a lot of them where the planets are going to cross in front of the star as they're orbiting it. And a planet being non-luminous itself, just reflects light, and generally a lot smaller than a star, as it passes in front of the star, it'll cause a dip in the star's light. That's called the photometric method. And it's not much, but with refined techniques now, it's incredible how sensitive the stuff is that we're detecting. So that is the method that you're primarily hearing about the discoveries of planets every day now, okay? Well, the crowning achievement of the photometric method has been the Kepler mission. Kepler's a spacecraft. Was launched to look at just a small piece of the summer sky, a piece of the constellation Cygnus and the adjoining constellation Lyra, okay? Not much space out there. And Kepler has discovered over 3,500 planetary systems, not just one star orbiting, planet orbiting a star, but systems just as we have here. Well, here's one of the announcements I wanted to share with you tonight. Every star has a zone around it. It's called the Goldilocks zone. Maybe you've heard of it, okay? That's where you're not too close to the star, so it's too hot. You're not too far from the star, so it's too cold. You're right in this zone, sweet zone, where water can stay liquid. And the sun, the Earth happens to be there. Mars is on one edge of it, and Venus is on the other, but the Earth is right in the middle of the sweet zone of the Goldilocks zone. The 3,700 planets that Kepler has already found over 600 are in the Goldilocks zone. Okay? It's now been announced that at least two, and probably more, but at least two of those planets, they have detected water vapor and carbon dioxide. Something is living on those planets. Maybe microbial life, it could be plant life, it could be humanoids, ETs, we don't know. Why should this be a big surprise, right? I mean, that there's other life out there. So that's really exciting stuff. And you're going to be hearing more and more about this, okay, as the techniques get even better refined. They're down now to where they can detect objects just about the size of the Earth. The early detected objects have been called super-Earths, and it's bigger than Jupiter, some of them, and hot planets. But anyway, there's a lot of activity going on there, okay? All right, let me see what I was going to do next, so I don't forget. Okay, water is everywhere, by the way. There's, as we're going to see in the images, about a half a dozen of the moons of the giant planets have oceans on them, okay? Ice-covered oceans. Water oceans, not methane, okay? Or anything like that. There's a star in Orion's one shoulder called Betelgeuse. It's almost as big as the solar system, because I passed Mars, almost to Jupiter. And it has about 100 million times the amount of water, and its outer atmosphere is on all the oceans here on the Earth. See, these giant stars are big red giants, and they get cool enough, it's steam, but there's water out there in some of those stars, okay? All right, well, the one other method I didn't mention, I'm glad I looked at this, is the direct method. See, all of these methods were indirect, theoretical, photometric, astrometric, spectroscopic. But now with these giant telescopes, and by the way, they are getting big. The Palomar telescope has long not been the biggest, the two Keck telescopes in Hawaii. Under construction now are telescopes, there's two of them. One is 1,200 inches across. 1,200, the Palomar telescope's 200. And the biggie is bigger than a tennis court, it is 1,600 inches across. Monsters, okay? And they're going to take us out certainly beyond the edge of the observable universe. So anyway, the point is, even backing up, even smaller telescopes like the Palomar telescopes or the Keck scopes, they can now see the Earth-like planets directly. They see planets are millions of times typically fainter than the star that's reflecting them or that they're orbiting. But the technology has gotten so good, we can actually now see the planet. So there's the theoretical method and four ways of detecting planets, okay? All right, let me say a few words about the search for extraterrestrial life with radio, okay? SETI, the SETI program. Mm-hmm. This is Astronomer's Punch, by the way. You laugh. You don't know about Astronomer's Punch? It's been published in Astronomy Magazine. A biochemist who was an amateur astronomer got tired of freezing his buns off on cold winter night, and he concocted, it's been published, he concocted this drink, and I've used it when I was teaching adult continuing ed classes. We use it on cold nights a lot. Anyway, apple cider, cinnamon, cloves, Galliano, I forget everything that's in it, but I can tell you this, it lights you up like a Christmas tree. Just, unfortunately, this is just water. By the way, do you know what the astronomer's excuse is for drinking? Wine particularly, it dilates the pupils. You see more at night. You've heard that, some of you? Don't believe it. It dilates the pupils, but it screws up the visual purple in the eye, the chemistry that lets you see fainter. So your eyes go boink, and the light sensitivity goes down. But don't tell anybody that. That's why we drink wine, you know. Astronomers are noted for this. Okay. Well, we're all familiar with the radio search for extraterrestrial life, because it's been around so long, over 50 years, hoping that some other civilization is sending signals to us. Primarily, they're looking at the water frequency line. And if you saw the movie Contact with Jodie Foster, again, Carl Sagan and his wife, Andrewian, did that screenplay. Do you know how long, the book's still on the bookmark, it's a big, thick paperback. Do you know how long it took him, despite his reputation? I worked with him on Cosmos. I mean, that a third of the people on planet Earth saw the original Cosmos. Despite that exposure, he was on the Carson show 32 times. Despite that exposure, it took 16 years to get Hollywood to do that movie. And if it wasn't for Jody Foster and Michael McConaughey interested in this, it may have never been made. Anyway, they were using the radio spectrum. They got prime numbers coming in, and then, you know, if you've seen it, if you haven't seen it, you've got to, okay? So, but they're also now looking in other parts of the spectrum. The visual spectrum, they're looking for laser pulses now at Harvard and several other observatories, possibly holographic in nature coming in. So there's that method. And some are actually designing neutrino telescopes, gravitational wave telescopes, other means of detecting possible signals coming to us, okay? But I wanted to suggest this to you, okay? If you were here from one of my previous lectures, stargazing, okay, I went through the metaphysical benefits, therapeutic relaxation, meditation, expansion of consciousness, spiritual enlargement, enrichment, contact, and finally astral travel or out-of-body experiences. Of those five, the one that's most exciting is expansion of consciousness. Because, you see, stargazers will tell you this, when you're out there in the wee hours of the night, and all the static, the mental static's died down, the tubes are off and everything, you will be out there and suddenly, out of nowhere, you will get, this thought comes through your mind, and you say, where'd that come from? And it's gone, okay? And all the greats, Einstein, Newton, Galileo, you just look at every one of their biographies and autobiographies, they all said their crowning thoughts, crowning insights came in a flash of insight. In some cases, for years they were working on a problem, and boom, there's the answer, out of nowhere, okay? Let me suggest this to you. Yes, communication is probably going on all over the galaxy and the universe itself. Radio, laser, holographic projections, possibly neutrinos, because they can go through a light year of lead without being stopped. But truly advanced civilizations may be communicating telepathically. Now, we're using about 5% of our brain, okay? What's the other 95% all about? And what I'm suggesting is they're not beaming a message to you particularly, but they may be communicating with other beings around the galaxy, and you're suddenly picking that thought up, and it's gone, okay? So if that may be something we're missing the boat on, they may be communicating with us, and we're not aware of it, okay? And people like Edgar Mitchell, just incredible. This image is from Edgar Mitchell, Apollo 14. I spent 3 days with him in Washington, D.C. 7 years ago. It was a 3-day congressional briefing, not a hearing, unfortunately, just a briefing, and to shake the hand of a man that has walked on another world. What a thrill, and he's such a humble person. He was just at the ARE in Virginia Beach a few weeks ago, and he talk about UFOs. He's one of the most outspoken proponents about them, okay, that they exist. Okay. So think about that, telepathic communication, and connect, in addition to all the other ones we're talking about. All right, let me say a few words about UFOs. I taught for 20-some years, besides astronomy courses, an adult continuing education course at the Community College in Pittsburgh. It was called Ufology, and then we had Ufology Advanced, and we had Ufology Field Investigation. And these weren't a bunch of wacko people, pilots, and doctors, and all, the whole gamut. And what I'm saying is that these were very serious people, a lot of pilots, because Allegheny Airlines at that time had their headquarters in Pittsburgh, and had a lot of them in my class. And what was I talking about? Yes, okay. Because of that teaching us, I got to know J. Allen Hynek quite well. He supplied materials for the class. I remember one of the messages I got from him, he said, if all of the students that you're dealing with have risen to the quality of some of the letters he got from them, the UFO subject just struck a bonanza, okay? But it's almost a no-win situation, okay? You could devote your whole life to investigating sightings and so on. The one thing that keeps coming up, Hynek realized it, Jacques Vallée, John Mack, a lot of the big names, Stanton Friedman, they have come to realize. And I just did a lecture on Sunday in Waynesboro, Virginia, and several people have had this experience. What they've come to realize is that UFOs, when you see them, if nothing else, they're opening people's minds. They're opening people's minds. as far as what makes them tick, and are they using zero-point energy, and are we reverse engineering them? That whole field is just so unbelievably complex. But people that have had a sighting, they will tell you, that happened in my childhood. The one woman said she was seven. She could still see it in her mind today, as if it just happened. So it is expanding. Whatever the phenomenon is, it's real, and it's expanding our consciousness, okay? All right, let's see. Is it ET time? What else I got here? Okay. Yes. Well, I told you I had an extraterrestrial. And I wasn't snowing you. It's not what you expected. The lecture I did on Sunday, people thought, because I went to the door and said, not yet. They really thought there was an ET up there. Anyway, this is an extraterrestrial visitor. I'm sure you'll recognize it right away. It's a meteor, or once they hit the ground, they're called meteorites. This is a little guy. There are meteorites in museums weighing up to 67 tons, okay? And we're bombarded constantly with these, have throughout history. You just look at the face of the moon. I mean, it's been meteoroid and asteroid impacts. But first of all, this is an extraterrestrial, because it is from off the Earth. This has been dated at 4.6 billion years old, the age of the Earth and the Sun. But folks, I want to tell you something right now. You're all hallucinating. This does not exist. You may think you're seeing a meteorite. Doesn't exist. And here's the story, and you'll see the connection with UFOs. The prestigious French Academy of Sciences, Louis Pasteur was a member, okay, made a pronouncement in the 1700s that, because there were reports coming in from all over the world, people reporting, farmers in their fields and workers in vineyards and that, seeing these things fall out of the sky, they'd walk over, pick it up, take it to the scientists, and say, Mr. Scientist, this fell from the sky. No, it didn't. Nothing could fall from the sky back then. It was immaculate, okay? The French Academy of Science, this is history, it exists, made an official pronouncement that nothing can fall from the sky. These don't exist. For 100 years, it set back the science of meteoritics, which is vital to our survival today. By the way, talk about being provided for by our Creator. We'll tell you what the sun's doing in just a minute or two here. We get into the images. But these things are burning up in the Earth's atmosphere continuously, okay? And there's a rain of meteoric dust just coming down through the air. And if it weren't for that dust, if you want to call it stardust, that would be good, it would rarely ever rain or snow on the planet Earth. Virtually every raindrop and every snowflake nucleates around a speck of stardust. Now, if we got any technical people here or teachers, they'll tell you, no, wait a minute, evaporated sea salt can do that. Volcanic ash can do that. That's all true. But the main reason that it rains and snows is because of these non-existent meteorites. So if anybody's skeptical about UFOs, keep that in mind. The pronouncements from on high, okay? All right. One other thing, and then we'll get into the images. I have a hard time promoting my own goods, okay, so to speak. This is my 10th book, and I have to take a minute to tell you something about it. And I have a few copies here, and before we go out to observe, my wife normally handles the sales, and she's not here tonight, so I'll have to try to do it. But I've got to tell you what this book is about. For 25 years, I've tried to get this book published. And I've tried all the mainstream publishers, New York, San Francisco, Los Angeles, New Age, whatever age, and kept getting rejections, okay? Too soon, interesting, no good, no market. The ones I really hated is when nobody wrote back, because you don't know what's wrong, okay? You couldn't learn from that. Anyway, 2 years ago, every 6 months, I would send a thing to another publisher, and I sent one to Hay House, who publishes Wayne Dyer and all, you know, Louise Hay. It's her, probably with offices all over the world. And I sent my proposal on a lark, 6 months, send it out by email. Almost instantly, I got an automated reply back. Sorry, no longer accepting unsolicited manuscripts or manuscripts submitted without an agent. Okay, put it in a file, try again in 6 months. 3 days later, I get an email from a woman at Hay House. She's an editor, senior editor. She said, I don't know how your proposal got on my desk, but number one, I love astronomy. And incidentally, I studied astronomy at Caltech. This is going to the president and to Louise Hay, and the rest is history. They did publish it, okay? And what makes us unique? It's a stargazing book, kind of like some of the stuff we talked about in one of my previous lectures. But there's lots of books on what to look at and how to look at things out in the sky. But everyone, without exception, have missed the soul of the night. They've missed the spirituality, okay? And as my friend David Levy, he's the 26 comets at last count, including the one that crashed into Jupiter in 21 days. He said, I didn't become an astronomer to learn the facts about the stars. I became an astronomer to celebrate its majesty, the majesty of the universe. So there's meditation exercises in here and so on, but we start on the planet Earth and end up at the quasars. And no pictures, as Mark pointed out. And I've always made it a policy wherever I speak to present a copy of either one of my DVDs or the book. But I did that the last time I was here, and Mark tells me it's in the circulating file, so I won't present it again. But if you have an interest, before we go outside, please see me. By the way, it's $15, and I do have change. All right, enough salesmanship. We're going to go now into space, okay? You're ready. I thought we'll go over here. And as some of you probably realize, I can't use a laser pointer on a screen like this, okay? That's a good regular projection screen, so I'll probably end up pointing. Well, as I've already mentioned, this is the beautiful planet Earth, taken by one of the Apollo 14 astronauts on their way back from the moon. By the way, that is the mission. That's another story. Could do all night on any one of these missions. It's amazing. But it's a beautiful oasis in space. This is our home. Buckminster Fuller called it Spaceship Earth. And the reason he did is, as you sit here right now listening to me gas away, we are moving seven different directions at seven different speeds. If we end up having a Q&A, we'll see. I'm glad to bring that up. We'll get to touch on some of them. But seven different speeds, seven different directions. So this is our home in space, okay? Now, this is something you'll rarely ever see from the Hubble telescope. And that's a picture of the moon, part of the moon. Why? Because Hubble was designed to go deep, okay? And every once in a while, though, they'll let their hair down and take a snapshot of something on the moon. This is the edge of the crater Copernicus, and some of these features on the floor of the crater are the size of a football field. When the James Webb telescope gets launched, if it does in 2016, at least theoretically they'll be able to show you a person standing there. Pretty amazing, huh? The world next door. And of all the images that come back from the space program, this one is the most electrifying that I'm going to show you next. It's Apollo 12, the second moon landing. And from the time that the astronauts set foot on the moon and started walking around, they kept talking among themselves and to Houston, there's a presence here. We feel something, but we don't see anything. Well, of the many pictures they took, which were confiscated and classified, through the Freedom of Information Act, they got this one released. One of the astronauts with a heavenly blue-green aura around them. And but let me assure you, that is real. That it's not a double exposure, emulsion flare, ionic blooming, or any of that stuff. Thousands of hours have been spent analyzing these pictures behind the scenes, but the astronauts themselves gave the simplest explanation, a public record. They're saying that glow was their guardian angel. Okay? How about that? Guardian angel. Okay, by the way, you talk to any astronauts, one of my former students was an astronaut, and they will tell you without belief in God and a higher power, they could never have made these incredible journeys. And one proof of that is on the first moon landing, Apollo 11, when they landed, before Neil Armstrong opened the capsule door, went down the ladder and said those famous words we've all heard many times, guess what happened inside the capsule? They had communion. Buzz Aldrin got permission from his bishop and took blessed wine, communion hosts, and a chalice to the moon. The first communion on another world was served on July 20th, 1969. And by the way, we all know who Tom Hanks is, the actor, producer. He's done some great stuff on the space program. The movie Apollo 13, that was his. Several years ago, you can get it, it's available, it's on DVD. He did a 12-part documentary called From the Earth to the Moon. From the Earth to the Moon. Yet episode 6, and you'll see the communion reenacted, and I promise you it'll send chills up your spine when they read that, the read from the Bible, actually, at one point. Well, here's our sun. Can everybody see this okay with the lights up? That's good. That's one nice thing about these high-intensity flat screens, okay? This is our daytime star, and it's our life star. It feeds us, it closes, it provides virtually all energy on the planet Earth except for nuclear energy itself, and it's just amazing. Inside the sun, you can put over 1 million planet Earths. A million of our worlds will fit in the sun, and the sun is classified as a yellow dwarf star. Dwarf star. There are stars that make the sun look like a pinpoint. They're enormous, okay? All sizes, going both ways, down and up, okay? So it's just an incredible sight. So you have to be careful about this, okay, looking at the sun. By the way, I've been at this since I was the age of 12. And my most embarrassed, I'm sharing some of these things because this is a small, intimate audience, okay? And I know Mark quite well. My most embarrassing moment in the 60-some years I've been an astronomer came when I was showing the sun to a school group at the Allegheny Observatory in Pittsburgh. And I was emphatically demonstrating how dangerous it is. We have this big telescope, and I'm up at the top of the ladder, and I take a telephone book and put it in the beam coming through the telescope. Catches on fire. Take a pencil, through the beam, snaps into flames. This is without a filter, okay? And I'm doing my dog and pony show, and at the bottom of the ladder, these are sixth graders, 60 of them, this boy is saying, "Mr. Mullaney," and that's exactly how he was talking, "Mr. Mullaney." Now, I like kids, okay? But he was ruining my spiel. "Mr. Mullaney," and I looked down the ladder and said, "What?" He said, "Your jacket's on fire." True story. You see, telescopes have a finder. Now, this is miniature, but the finder on that scope was huge. And I had forgot to cap the finder before I was doing my thing on the sun. So you got to be careful, okay? But the sun's our daytime star. Now, by the way, for perspective, every second that's going by on your watch right now, the sun is taking 5 million tons of its mass and converting it to the energy of 1 million hydrogen bombs. There's 1 million hydrogen bombs, another million. And the sun is only halfway through its long life. Okay, this is the planet Venus. It's currently in the evening sky. It's over in the west behind all those trees right now. But that brilliant object in the west is the planet Venus. It goes through phases, as you see here, and shrouded in a very, very dense atmosphere. Okay. Now, we all recognize that. That's Mars, of course, and showing one of its polar ice caps and the hood around the bottom. It's got one ice cap. It's winter. The bottom one is melted because it's summer. Clouds, dust storms, the mysterious blue-green markings, still controversial. They go through a seasonal cycle, but they're not plants or vegetation. We're not sure what they are. And you probably have heard, but we know there's water on Mars because of the ice caps, but they have now found very strong evidence for liquid water, okay, as well as vapor. There's clouds, there's water vapor clouds. But they have now have images of drops of water dripping from the struts of some of the landers before they sublimate. And the latest is one where there is water apparently going down a gully inside a crater. There's water everywhere there, okay? And I think the quantity they're estimating right now is the amount of water on Mars subsurface is around the amount of water in Lake Erie, okay? That was just published. So, okay, interesting world. This is the world between Mars and Jupiter. It's one of the asteroids. In fact, it's the largest asteroid called Ceres. There's tens of thousands of these have been cataloged. There's probably millions of them, ranging from little chunks of material like that meteorite to Ceres, and we have a spacecraft in orbit around that now. You probably have or will be seeing some images directly from it. This is from the Hubble telescope. But it's pretty amazing that there's this zone of rubble out there, and we have no idea how it got there. Edgar Cayce's readings indicate it was a planet that got disrupted. Others think it was material that never got to form into a planet. But we are under bombardment, as I indicated earlier, and it's constant. The week before Christmas last year, whether you heard about this or not, I don't know, because everybody's all Santa Claus crazed, an asteroid a mile long, okay, made of solid iron and rock, moving at 40,000 miles an hour, came between the Earth and the Moon 10 times closer than the Moon itself. That's a near miss. And it's going on all the time. So we're waking up to the fact that we're under bombardment. All kinds of surveys are going on now to find these things. Question is, if we find one that's headed with our name on it, what can we do about it? So NASA's doing a lot of studies on it. Well, this is the beautiful planet Jupiter. And Jupiter contains about 1,200 Earths you could put inside that planet. It is the giant planet of the solar system. This is its magnificent red spot, which contains organic molecules. Jupiter is one of the two targets I would like to try to pick out tonight. Ain't going to look like this, okay? It'll look like an exquisite piece of cosmic jewelry. I'm only going to be using a very low magnification. And depending on where they are around the planet, it's four bright moons, the ones discovered by Galileo. I can tell you when we actually look at it. At last count, Jupiter has 63 moons and counting, okay? Four of which, well, at least three for sure, especially Europa, is ice-covered and has a liquid water ocean on it, okay? Then for sheer beauty and magnificence, I just put this in there. This is a view deeper down into the atmosphere, and there's the shadow of several of its moons. And in your backyard with a little telescope, you can actually see the moons orbiting the planet from hour to hour, crossing in front of it, going behind it, disappearing into Jupiter's shadow. It's like a four-ring circus, since there's four of them. Look at this.
Wow.
You got to see this to believe it. Now, if we should see Saturn tonight, it's going to be very tiny. I'll probably use 100 power on it. But that's not, it looks again like an exquisite piece of cosmic jewelry. And you're seeing the real thing. That's what really gets to you. These rings are composed of billions of chunks of rock and ice. They're 170,000 miles across, but they're less than 100 feet thick in most places. And to illustrate that, as Saturn goes around the Sun, we orbit the Sun, we see the rings at different angles. That black thing is not the ring, it's the shadow of the ring. That's the ring, that little thin line. And here's the shadow of Saturn's mysterious moon. It has 60 moons at last count. That's the moon Titan, which has an atmosphere. Can't be. Defies all the laws of physics. Has a methane atmosphere. They landed on it and so on. It's a mystery how it got there and why it has an atmosphere. The next planet out is Uranus, and it's four times as big as the planet Earth. And the thing about it is this, the moon, there's rings here and there's moons. You may not be able to see them very well, but all four giant planets have rings and moons. Not as spectacular as Saturn and Jupiter. But you can see the bands go vertically. So they didn't put this image wrong. This is the world that has flipped over 98 degrees on its side. Something flipped that giant world over. If you're more interested in this, by the way, Venus is upside down and rotates backwards. They believe Mars's polar caps were on the equator at one time. We know this world flipped over, and it seems to be a kind of a natural thing for worlds to flip over and cleanse themselves, as the Native Americans say. Anyway, if you're interested in this, read the book Pole Shift by John White. Pole Shift, ARE Press, by John White. Very scholarly work. Now, the last of the real planets, I'll explain that in a minute, is Big Blue. May not look that big to you. This is Neptune, again, four times the size of the Earth. Now, get the picture here. This is 1.6 billion miles out, okay? 2.6 billion miles out. It's at the cloud tops there. It's 350 degrees below zero Fahrenheit, but it's cold, okay? This is not totally confirmed, but it looks like it is the case. There appears to be a global liquid water ocean on that planet. Now, who would ever thought you could go swimming on a world like that? Yes, the cloud tops are unbelievably cold, but these giant planets are so big, they're compressing under their gravitational weight and giving off more weight internally than they're getting from the Sun. And then the next planet is poor Pluto. This is a recent image from Hubble. Normally, it's just a little spot. And you've probably heard the news. By the way, there is a spacecraft going to fly by Jupiter next month. I'm sorry, it's July, okay? It's going to fly by Jupiter. Then it's going to fly by Pluto and give us our first close-up look. Pluto and its five moons. Now, you probably heard a number of years ago, after the astronomers get together, by the way, every 3 years internationally, and after an entire week of heavy drinking, they demoted Pluto to a Plutoid. I know these people, okay? And the International Astronomical Union devoted Pluto to a Plutoid. Sounds like a disease, doesn't it? Well, not everybody's happy with this, and there's a motion afoot to reinstate it as a planet, but there was a reason for this. Pluto is smaller than our own moon, okay? Not much of a planet, smaller than our own moon, and as I said, it has five moons of its own, which are probably captured asteroids or whatever, but out of respect for Clyde Tombaugh, the discoverer, and Walt Disney and his movie, you know, anyway, point is, they may reinstate Pluto as a planet, but beyond Pluto is a whole host of worlds. Sedna is another one you may have heard about. It's actually bigger than Pluto. It's another ice ball. There's a host of these ice balls going out into the depths of interplanetary space. So that's why they did what they did, okay? But now we look at the stars. This is a piece of the night sky as big as your thumb held out at the end of your arm. Every dot on that picture, every spot, is a star, a sun. And it's interesting, we've already talked about a couple of you came in after we mentioned about I had a container of sand grains up here, but for every grain of sand on the planet Earth, there's 10,000 stars, suns, within reach of our largest telescopes. And by the way, those star colors are real. Red stars are relatively cool. Blue stars are relatively hot. In between stars are yellow. There's even some green stars. So where did this all come from? Well, we do know now, out of a particle smaller than a subatomic particle itself, an enormous cosmic fireball occurred 13.76 billion years ago. They got it down that close, okay? And you've heard the term, the Big Bang, okay? Let me assure you it happened. It's interesting that among the religious community, a lot of people didn't like this, and I've never understood why, but guess who came up with the Big Bang theory? Father George Lemaître, a Roman Catholic priest and a cosmologist. And Pope Pius XII, when this was announced, he didn't condemn it. He said, I love it. It perfectly explains the opening verse of Genesis when God said, let there be light. And there it is. Out of that process came this amazing burst of energy which started coupling with matter. And giant clumps of matter started forming these enormous groups of galaxies, okay? And in the galaxies themselves, stars started being born in these incubators, these star nurseries. These are mainly made out of hydrogen with some helium and some heavy elements, but by the way, none of these pictures are doctors. This is an artist's conception. These are all direct images from the Hubble. And this is called the Orion Nebula. They all have catalog designations. I won't lay that on you because it'll put you to sleep. But we give these popular names so we can relate to them. This is in the Sword of Orion, and on a clear winter's night, if you have a pair of binoculars, you can see it. It looks like an emerald green little fuzzball. You aren't going to see it like this, but the point is you can see stars being born if you look, okay? So isn't that magnificent? And this is these are all now stars that are in the process of forming. And in a few minutes, we'll look at stars in the process of dying, okay? Beautiful. Look at this. These stars have obviously started shining, and they're taking their energy, is pushing away the embryonic material from which they were formed, okay? That's the embryonic material. Just look at that. Isn't that magnificent? Some of these look like psychedelic paintings.
Yeah.
Look at that. There's another example. The veil is being pushed back. Yeah, the veil's being pushed back. And there's a group of stars. This is called the Magic Mountain or the Mystic Mountain. Isn't that amazing? That's out there. This is called the Cosmic Tornadoes or Twisters. Excuse me. No, we're not sure exactly what's going on here, but this circulating material is forming a star, probably a group of stars, and their planets. This is called the Conch Shell Nebula. Pretty amazing. This is one of the iconic pictures from the Hubble Space Telescope. I know you've all seen it. One of the earliest pictures. And they just re-imaged this again. It's even more magnificent with the newer technology. But although you've all seen this, most likely, I want to show you something you may have never noticed before. Right here is a ball, a red ball, with a ring around it. You see, remember we were talking earlier about how stars form? And the ice skater analogy I did, the rings of material coming out of the star. That is a protostar. It's glowing red hot, but it's not hot enough for thermonuclear reactions. Guess how short a time it takes for the star to turn on. It takes millions of years for this incubation, but the star goes thermonuclear 3 minutes. In 3 minutes, the star will look like that. And that is one of the sacred privileges of being an astronomer today. We can watch this happening right in front of our eyes. 3 minutes? That's just amazing, isn't it? First time in history we ever had this opportunity. Again, star in the center being born, pushing out the material from which, and actually if you look carefully, there's other stars that were inside of it. It's like a family spreading out, okay, after the kids grow up, so to speak. This is the brightest star in the sky besides the sun. That's the star Sirius. It's in the winter sky. And here's its little white dwarf companion. It's a star as big as the sun, as massive as the sun, compressed down to smaller than the Earth. But this is obviously a blue star and a very hot star, the star Sirius. Now, this is a double star. These are twin suns orbiting each other. Turns out that at least 80% of the stars in the sky are double or multiple stars, and they're orbiting each other. And they're all, this isn't a spectacular one, they're all different colors. You could have an emerald green, ruby red, a turquoise, and a lavender sun all shining in your sky at the same time, not just one yellow sun. And they go up from there, even the larger groupings. But these two stars are orbiting each other every 81 minutes. Suns, 81 minutes, okay? It's unbelievable. Just like to be out there, you know? Now, this looks like a star and a double star, but it's not. This was one of the first direct images of a planet. That is a planet. Doesn't look like much, but it's a direct image. It's no longer indirect. They had to block out the star, the brightness of the star, and there's one of the first images of a planet. Now, as stars evolve in these nebulas, they form star clusters, not just one or two or three or a few dozen at a time, hundreds of them, thousands of them, and they're called stellar jewel boxes, okay? And they're like pieces, again, of exquisite cosmic jewelry, all right? And here we go again. And then they form into larger groups, up to 100,000 stars. Now remember, everything we're looking at is in our galaxy, okay? We're not talking about other galaxies yet. In just a minute we will, but this thing has over 100,000 stars in it. Now, this object is one of the closest, we call them stellar beehives or globular clusters. This is one of the closest, okay? The light that made that image left there 24,000 years ago when the cavemen were still hunting mastodon. It's just now getting here, 24,000 years ago. It's in our backyard, so to speak. By the way, the first night I ever saw this through my telescope in the backyard, trying to remember the exact sort of point is that it was a warm summer night. This is in the constellation Hercules, and it was hot that night. So the neighbors, they were used to me doing weird things, you know, wearing a hood over my head to keep the light pollution out. But the first night I saw this, I said, oh my God. And this is at 3 a.m, by the way. How can anyone be sleeping when this is out there? And the next thing I hear is windows going bam, bam, bam. And someone said, we're not sleeping any longer. But they're just magnificent. Here's a view closer in on one of those. Can you imagine what the sky would look like living in something with 100,000 Venuses shining like that? Okay, now we're going to switch now to dying stars. We've seen how they're born. We'll see how they die. It's not a sad thing because, as you'll see, they don't die, okay? They don't really die. Some stars, the rare heavyweights, do this. They literally blow themselves to smithereens and scatter their remains throughout space. This is the famous Crab Nebula, okay? Again, almost all of these can be seen in the backyard telescope. Not like this, but you can look at this, okay? And here's another example. Most stars, though, when they die, get to the end of their fuel reserve, so to speak, when their hydrogen supply runs out, they don't explode, they do this. They silently and very gracefully shed their outer layers. And by the way, let me back up for a minute. This has been on the net for a while as the Eye of God. That's fine. It's actually called the Helix Nebula. Here's the original Eye of God. Whoa. I think that looks more like it.
Yeah.
And you see, it looks like an iris and so on, but you see, nothing is standing still out there. Everything's moving. So how did this happen? The star is moving. And as it's moving, it's leaving behind smoke rings, so to speak, okay? Mm-hmm. Now, this is called the Snail Nebula. Some people call it the Cat's Eye, I'm not sure why. This is called the Rose Nebula. And the poet Longfellow said that the stars are the forget-me-nots of the angels, okay, in the meadows of heaven. How about that? Very, very poetic, but that's very true. This is the famous Ring Nebula in the summer sky. You can see that in a pair of binoculars. A very small telescope will show the hole in it, okay? Again, none of these are going to look like that to a backyard telescope. And this is the Sand Dollar Nebula. Some people call it the Lemon Wedge. How does stuff get out there? How? I mean, is God, we know he's a magician. Is he a geometer and a mathematician and so on? He, she? It's just amazing. These things just didn't happen, okay? This is called the Jellyfish Nebula. Now, folks, the telescope was not vibrating. Let me assure you, the Hubble wasn't doing that in orbit or it would have come down, okay? The jellyfish is vibrating while it was being photographed. Physically impossible at that scale, but it's vibrating. This is called the Rainbow Nebula, and you can see how fast stars spin both when they were being born and as they're dying. Everything's spinning, everything's moving. This is the Spirograph Nebula. If you played with one as a child, you'll know. Look at all the eddies in there. Star in the center, where it's still very hot, and as the material moves out, it cools down and then disappears into interstellar space. This is the, I discovered this, it's called the Blinking Planetary Nebula, and it actually, while we were calling out the Allegheny Observatory, doing a survey, and we came across this object one summer night and couldn't believe our eyes, because it blinks on and off. Okay? It has to do with the scanning frequency of the eye and averted vision, but people see this through a telescope, they flip out. You know, there's something doing this to you. Okay. This is the Angel Nebula. And, I'm sorry, let me back up. This is the Butterfly Nebula. We'll see an Angel Nebula in a minute. This is the Butterfly Nebula. And I think it's so appropriate our Creator put a butterfly in the heavens because, as you know, butterflies are a symbol for transformation and rebirth, okay? And guess what happens to the material coming out of these dying stars? They rebirth the star. From the ashes of the old, the new stars are born. And if you're ever wondering why we have this preoccupation with the heavens, why we want to go out there, why we want to look at the stars with telescopes, Eric Hoffer, the waterfront philosopher, they called him, said it's a homing impulse. It's where we're drawn from. We're drawn to where we came from, okay? And indeed, all the materials in our bodies, the calcium in your fingernails, teeth, and bones, the iron flowing through your bloodstream right now, okay? The carbon that makes up all the cells in your body, in fact, the potassium in your brain, so you could understand this program tonight, all came from dying stars. And it's been recycled into new stars and new people, okay, new living creatures. So, and this isn't the only butterfly the Hubble has found. Here's another one. Isn't that magnificent? I'll let you soak that up for a minute. Okay. Well, pretty amazing. Stars are born, stars die, they're reborn. Kind of a message here for people, huh? Okay. And now we go to the galaxies, the ultimate objects in the universe. We're living in one of these giant spiral pinwheels. We call it the Milky Way, from that band of light that crosses the sky, especially noticeable in the summer months, okay? Passes right overhead. And light takes 100,000 years to cross one of these things. There's typically a trillion suns in them. You can obviously tell they're spinning. We live out near the boondocks, and it takes 200 million years for us to make one galactic rotation, okay? And we see them with face on, we see them tilted at different angles. Here's another one. This is more like what the Milky Way would look like if you could get out there and see it. And we're about 30,000 light years out, somewhere around here, from the core of the star, okay? Love to know what's going on at the galactic meetings at the core, okay? Encyclopedia Galactica, Carl Sagan called it, okay? See, the galactic community is waiting for us to grow up and join them. And, I mean, can you imagine what their religion is like, their art, their music, their science? And it's all out there, okay, waiting for us. And we also see galaxies, oh, This is a close-up of the core of that galaxy. Looks like a blizzard, doesn't it? Those aren't snowflakes. Those are stars. Wow. It's just stars upon stars upon stars without number. And then some galaxies are edge-on like this, or nearly so. This is the famous Sombrero galaxy, when the dark material rounds its equatorial zone. This object is, remember the star cluster where the light took 24,000 years to get here? That was in our galaxy. This is one of the near galaxies. You can see it in your backyard with a good-sized pair of binoculars, and definitely on a telescope. The light that made this image took 30,000 years to get here, okay? That's 30 million years to get here. This is 30 million light years away. And again, it's one of our neighbors in a sense. And galaxies, well, first of all, stars themselves never collide. They're just so far apart. Stars do coalesce in binary systems. They will come together. We now know that neutron stars coalesce. In fact, they've just announced that some of the gamma ray bursts are coming from two black holes that have been orbiting each other, and they've merged into a super black hole, okay? So that's not a collision. That's kind of a part of the design. But stars are so far apart, the chances of them ever hitting each other is infinitely small. And by the way, with all the stars we have talked about, you must wonder, don't they hit each other? They're all huge, they're moving at incredible speeds. The chance that any two stars will ever collide, this is a statistical calculation, again, done like the sand grains, is the same that if you took a fly here in Phoenixville and somebody halfway around the world, say in Australia, Sydney, Australia, had a fly, and you let them go at the same time. The chance that the fly from Phoenixville will ever bump into the fly from Australia is the chance that two stars will ever collide. But stars don't collide, but galaxies are so huge as they move through space majestically, they do collide occasionally, and this is the merger of two galaxies. The stars are totally unaffected, but the gas, the hydrogen gas in the galaxies reignites, and starburst starts all over again. In a sense, that's an embryo, okay? It's a galactic embryo starting the process all over again. And as stars form clusters, so do galaxies. This is a galaxy cluster. Almost everything on this screen is a galaxy, okay, with up to anywhere from 500 billion to a trillion stars. Well, a few years ago, and it's been repeated, you may have heard of the Hubble Deep Image, but as a Christmas gift to the human race, the Hubble Space Telescope took a piece of sky as big as one grain of sand. And it not only kept pointed at that sand grain, but kept imaging it for 100 hours as the Hubble's orbiting the Earth at 18,000 miles an hour, 5 miles a second. What an incredible technological achievement. On Christmas Eve, they released this picture, where the Hubble telescope, no telescope on the Earth showed anything. It was a blank piece of sky. In that sand grain, 10,000 galaxies alone, just in that speck. Every one loaded with stars. Okay. Well, I promise you the last couple slides are mind blowers. First of all, almost like the meteorite I showed you, which science said couldn't exist, this next thing cannot exist. And here it is in the Hubble Space Telescope. It's the red rectangle. Been in the files for a while. They've been sitting on it. No one was ever sure what this thing is. They finally, heard through the grapevine it was in the file, so it's been released. You can go to hubblesite.org, and there's 7,500 images in that file, and click on the gallery, and there's 1,000 to whet your appetite. It's in there, the red rectangle. First of all, folks, you can't have a rectangle in space. Everything is either round or elliptical. No triangles, no squares, no rectangles. But there it is. They just released the image, and I don't have it yet. You see these things? They appear to have, the one report from the Astrophysical Journal said, they appear to have theater lighting. There's little spots of light on each of those rungs. I don't know what it is. Astronomers certainly don't know what it is. It can't be there, but it is out there. Okay, it's in the constellation Cygnus. By the way, it's coming toward us. I'm going to throw this out just for food for thought. The first astronomer to actually see the shape of this at Kitt Peak National Observatory, he said, "Oh my God, It's the New Jerusalem. Something maybe to think about. I don't know, but it is coming our way. Look at this. The next image. The ring of pearls. What is that ring of light? It reminds me of something from Close Encounters of the Third Kind, doesn't it, when the mothership came down? But more importantly, what is that inside? Some people think Mother Mary, Christ, an ascended master. Here's a new picture that was just released. I don't think it's as good, but one guy on Sunday said it's a parrot.
Yeah.
I guess it kind of looks like a parrot. I don't know.
The
important thing is that it has changed shape from the earlier image. It didn't look like that on the first image, okay?
Over what time period?
About 10 years. Yeah, it's cosmically speaking, it just happened. Finally, the last image I'm going to show you, and then I want to end with two quotes, and then I'll check the sky. I didn't forget. The last image was taken in the Pleiades star cluster, okay? You've all heard of this, probably seen it. It's magnificent through a pair of binoculars. And before I tell you, or show you the final image, because I'll show you which star they photographed, I was giving a lecture about 20 years ago. I'm an old fart, okay? I've been doing this since the age of 12. At the New York Open Center on Spring Street in New York, Manhattan. Does that ring a bell? World Trade Centers were here. They weren't built yet, okay? And I had done an evening lecture, and I brought my telescope. I always drag it along. And a pretty good sized group. And we were outside on the sidewalk outside the Open Center. And the last object I showed them was the Pleiades. Across the street was a woman walking down the walkway. And she stopped and she looked, kind of not the best area in town maybe. And she was hesitant, but she finally kind of hesitated and walked over and said, "What are you doing?" I said, "We're looking through a telescope." "Oh, I would love to," she said. "I've never looked through a telescope in my life." So we showed her the Pleiades, and she said, with tears in her eyes, "Oh my God, that's my home." Hmm. How did she know that? Home, 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 home. I don't know if there's a connection, but she was at a genetic level. You know, it's in the genes, okay? Wow. We were made of star stuff, and she claims she was from there, okay? And it's just amazing. Anyway, surrounding this star right here, the Hubble telescope, they just keep taking more and more incredible images, all right? The Hubble telescope has taken a picture of essentially a flock of angels attending a newborn star. How about that? Officially, it's just a nebula. But take a good look at that. Why couldn't the Creator have sent a flock of beings? And we talk about extraterrestrial life. Remember, it could be part of it would be the angelic realm. They're extraterrestrials. Christ was an extraterrestrial. Anybody from off the planet, you know, and people get bent out of shape sometimes when you mention things like that. But the angelic realm exists. We all know that. And so maybe they had took part in the birth of the star, at least watching over it, okay? Now, I'd like to end with two quotes. First of all, one of the things Carl Sagan always was so adamant about is that we need that cosmic perspective. If we don't channel our energies outward, we're going to self-destruct. Stephen Hawking just released a thing. He thinks we're going to do ourselves in. Is it going to be an asteroid impact? It's not going to be a CME, coronal mass ejection from the sun. It's going to be us, and given what's going on the planet Earth. Anyway, every big telescope has what's called first light, okay? First light. And what that is, it's usually the person that paid for the telescope or the foundation. They point the telescope at some significant object and the person looks in, okay? Well, the Carnegie Institution and my Caltech people, anyway, when the Palomar telescope was dedicated in 1948, they had 600 people on the floor of the observatory, six stories up. Raymond Fosdick, president of the foundation, was the first human being to look into the telescope. And if you could read the dedication address, it's just amazing. But one of the things he said that's so significant is, adrift in a cosmos, who sure as he can't even imagine, man spends his energy fighting with his fellow man over issues which a single look through this telescope would show to be utterly inconsequential. Every politician, every religious leader, every military partner, all of us need to look through a good telescope, okay, to get our priorities straight. And finally, again, in view of what's going on in the world, I find this quote very comforting, but also in view of the majesty we've seen here in such a short time, I think it's very appropriate. It comes from the composer Beethoven, from his immortal piece of music called Ode to Joy. And in Ode to Joy, Beethoven says, he took this from a different person, Schiller, but Beethoven says, "Surely above the starry firmament, a loving father must dwell." Some of you know that. I see somebody repeating it. Great. So if you have any questions while we're here. Yes?
Two quick ones. The Hubble, when is that retiring? What's the James Webb telescope supposed to be? What's the purpose
of it?
Well,
Hubble hopefully will never retire. You know, all this government money spent on stuff that doesn't count. And it was only public pressure to finally save the Hubble because everyone's just like to burn up, come in and burn up. It could be good for another 10 years, okay? All depends on the solar cells and the gyroscopes that are in there. I have a feeling the public will rally for some kind of a mission. We don't have anything that can go up there right now. So ironic to me that we need the Russians to get us up to the space station we built, okay? Largely built ourselves. The James Webb is a telescope so big that the shield on it is bigger than a tennis court, okay? It makes the Hubble look tiny. And theoretically, again, it's mainly looking in the red part of the spectrum, but it will be able to pick up objects, as I said, the size of a human on the moon. That's not why they're building it. The James Webb will let us go out to the edge of the observable universe. One of the men on the project, it's a woman actually, one of the persons said, when the James Webb goes into operation, we're gonna look right into the face of God. Wow. And why she said that? Because it'll take us out to the Big Bang. Mm-hmm. Yeah, and that's 2016 now. They keep moving it, okay?
Yeah.
Keep shoving. NASA just had its budget horribly cut. I don't know if you know about this watchdog.
Yeah.
The guy doesn't even believe in global warming, okay, among other things. But anyway, sorry, do you have a question? Was it you?
Yes. I was wondering if it would be possible to hold your meteorite. That would be a lifetime drill for me.
Can I ask you this? We need, really, idealistically, about 10 more minutes for the sky to get dark enough, okay? I could go out there and... Could we pass this around very quickly? Now, I'm going to tell you something while we're doing it. Since you asked, let's start over here. And just rub it and pass it around. There is a legend throughout the world in indigenous cultures, mainly in the Orient. By the way, let me back out. Just remind you, the Pleiades... The Orientals, especially the Japanese, are really into the Pleiades. You know the car Subaru, that symbol's the Pleiades, okay? They're very celestially oriented. But, what was I talking about? See, this is why I depend on my wife. Hun, what was I just talking about? What did you just ask me?
I asked if I could hold them.
Oh, me, right, you did. But there was something else I was going to talk about. I know. There's a legend. Is this a senior moment or what? There's a legend throughout the world that if you see a shooting star, you don't even have to see it, but if you a shooting star comes on, that's what we call meteorites, okay, popular call shooting star. If you pick one of these up, okay, and rub it really good, it's supposed to bring you love, luck, wealth, health, fame down the line. For most of my career, I would do that, I would mention that, pass the meteorite around, and say, give it a try, it's never worked for me. Well, at a conference outside of Philadelphia 24 years ago, my dear friend Warren was there and his wife, we passed the meteorite around, and this beautiful redhead named Sharon was rubbing it. 6 weeks later, we were engaged, and 6 months later, we were married, and Marge and Warren were at the wedding, so it works.
You didn't tell me this before I wrote it.
Yeah, that wasn't fair. I'll give you another.
Go ahead.
I have a general question about the photographs. What exactly, what kind of spectrum are they photographing? Is it infrared? Is it a whole string? Or is it just what we would see?
Oh, that's a good question. A few of the images you saw for research purposes, had different filters put on them so they could go deeper. And, but again, if you go to the Hubble site, hubblesite.org, click on the gallery, and even down in the corner is some of a lot of the pictures that says gallery. Those have been matched exactly to what the human eye will see.
So if we were out there,
when we return to the stars, we came from the stars. Okay. And we're destined to return to the stars. Okay? And talk to a Native American, the Great Purification. Mm-hmm. Uh-oh. Mm-hmm. I just thought of something. We're killing time, but it's worthwhile. Oh, you didn't get it yet.
There you go. There you go.
The Native Americans are talking very heavily and have been for a long time about the Great Purification. Well, okay, a lot of you have heard that. Mm-hmm. They have two requirements before this actually comes about. Number one, the white man will put his house in the sky, International Space Station. Number two, you get another chance. Thank you for asking. Number two, every home in its living area will have a black box, and the box will have a window in it, and it'll issue forth blasphemy. Sound familiar? Television? They both have happened. The Native Americans are ready, and it probably would be a pole shift. We don't know. So, or the Lord could come back and take us all off the planet that are. Oh, okay. That's not, that was the signal. Beam me up, Scotty.
What's the chemical composition of that?
Oh, I'm glad you asked. There's different kinds of meteorites. There's iron, there's nickel, carbonaceous chondrites, there's stoning. This is a glass meteorite called a tektite. Tektite. They make jewelry out of this. If you give me a pizza, I'm sorry. Give me 5 minutes in your backyard and a pizza and I'll find you one of these. They're all over the place. I'm not that it necessarily would be this big, but most of the time you're walking on these things. Soil has meteoritic dust in it, and sometimes there'll be chunks of it, and they make rings and other kind of jewelry out of this, so it's called a tektitis glass. Thanks for asking. Yes?
What is the age of our Milky Way in relative to the universe?
Okay, it's the age of the universe, as far as we can tell. The sun is 4.5 billion years old, the solar system, but we now know that we're at least a third and possibly as many as a fifth generation star within the galaxy. And we're 4.5 billion years old. Mm-hmm. So the galaxy is ancient, and that checks out with the age of the universe itself. It has. Don't anybody tell you that that the universe is 4,000 years old or a couple million. And it isn't even a couple billion. The way heavy elements are made inside of stars, and we wouldn't be here if it weren't for them. The recycling of heavy elements takes anywhere from 11 to 14 billion years to happen. In other words, it is an ancient universe. If it wasn't, we wouldn't be here to think about it. I love what Carl Sagan says, we're the universe thinking about itself. Yes. Is that awesome? Yeah. Is that awesome or what? Yes, sir. I'm sorry.
You mentioned earlier in terms of the number of planets that have been found. Mm-hmm. You mentioned that there's been oxygen and carbon dioxide. And you then said that because of that, you believe that there's life there. Isn't it possible that water and carbon dioxide can be produced without life?
Yeah, achemical, abiological. Yeah, even on Mars, they just announced a couple of weeks ago they have found bursts of carbon monoxide, okay? Carbon dioxide, okay? And first thought was it's some kind of biological activity, but it's coming and going, and they're showing that it could be due to soil and certain things like that. Yes, you're right. But I think it's only a question of time before we either get a signal from one of these places or we actually get a complete spectrum. Right now, they're just picking up a couple primary things in the spectrum. But especially when the 1200 inch and the 1600 inch come online. Well, I mean, they can already see the atmospheres of some of the planets, but we're really not able to do a complete spectral analysis. But that's a good point, yes. But I don't think we're alone. I sure hope not. Yes.
Since there are UFOs on this planet and have been visiting us for probably centuries, mm-hmm. What are people who are in astronomy or into looking in the skies looking for? Other life forms other than these UFO creatures, or what?
Well, You know about professional astronomers, is that right? Astrobiologists, people like that?
Yeah.
Any kind of signature that would be lifelike, but when you get into mentioning UFOs, boy, red flags go up all over the place, and they don't want to hear it, you know. So some are, Seth Capone's had it at the Sade Institute, and Jan Taylor, that's not her first name. Anyway, the one that in Contact that Jodie Foster played, Jill Tarter, who was her, that was, she was playing Jill Tarter at the Sade Institute. They're looking for signals from beings like us or even more advanced, okay? But they're astronomers too, very top notch. But the astronomical community kind of looks down on them as a bunch of wackos. Same when you even touch Dr. Hynek, you know, he wrote the standard textbook on astrophysics at Northwestern. But everybody thought he'd gone off the deep end, you know.
Jim, I happen to have a story about Phoenixville and UFOs.
Uh-oh.
I worked here many, many years, last century. And worked at the instruments division of the Butt Company out on 113, just before you get to Nut Road. And on the way driving there one day, there was a triangular-shaped field right next to the road. And there was a nice big round spot in the middle of that triangular field that looked like it was burned out. And nothing grew there for about 3 years. The other thing when I was working there, is I missed it. I walked inside and I heard later from the women who came in behind me at lunchtime, there was a UFO outside, we just saw it. And they're looking up, there's a disc there at an angle in the sky hanging there above the place where we worked. Took off north, and the local newspaper, I can't think of the name of it right now, not the one in Phoenixville, another newspaper, had reports of people all along that way north seeing it. Mm-hmm. So yeah, you've visited.
Mm-hmm. We saw one a couple of years ago in the backyard.
My wife's sisters in Wisconsin, all kinds of stories about the ones they saw. Her father and I saw a red light in the field where there was nothing there at nighttime. It goes on and on. Yeah, they're with us.
Yes,
good thing
thank
our sighting was we saw in my friend's backyard, and about 3 or 4 days later we were talking to neighbors a couple blocks off, and they started describing exactly what we saw at the same time the same night. So we weren't the only ones that had looked up, and every single one of us were just
watching.
I was like, that's cool.
They've been working with us for centuries.
Yes. Millions of people have had sightings and have been discredited. As Sam Friedman says, the testimony would stand up in a court of law is dismissed immediately by that same person if they claim they saw a UFO or had an encounter.
Jim, the man from Canada that we talked about.
Stanton Friedman? Or?
No, it's the other person. Would say, yeah, they're here.
Something B. Smith, what is his name? Yeah, he was Minister of Defense or something over in Canada.
Exactly.
He said they're here. Brazil has acknowledged their existence. France has, for darn sure. Jacques Vallée and company, I mean, France has had more UFO sightings than any place in the world. We're the ones that are reluctant, and there's some theories about why we're not being open about it, okay? It's called vested interest. You had a question.
I'm sorry, I don't have another interesting UFO story for you. But, my question was, I think you said that it takes heavy elements about at least 11 billion years
to recycle from one generation star to the next.
Okay, and if heavy elements are required for higher forms of animal life or intelligent life, then there could not have been any intelligent life when the universe was less than at least 11 billion years old.
Okay, if we're talking biological, no, that's good logic, but you have to realize something. We've already been invaded by another form of intelligent life, and it's called silicon. It's reproducing itself now. Silicon chips are making silicon machines are making silicon chips. Our whole society is based on this, but that's a very good point. And they're not just looking for biological carbon-based life now. They're looking at other forms that, like you said, that's very astute, because if it took that long to get the heavy elements to make us, maybe there are beings that don't need these heavy elements, but silicon.